Welcome to the first session of our brand new series, Gaining Ecosystem Advantage from the London Business School. My name is David Lancefield. And I'm here with my good friend, Professor Michael Iacobides. Our aim is to give you some fresh insights, some ideas, some practical tips to help you succeed in your participation in ecosystems, whether you're an orchestrator, a complementer, a business person, a consultant. And we're inviting some wonderful guests from the world of business, academia, and consultancy who are, exchange their own experiences and research. This is not a lecture. This is intended to be a debate. So get ready to share your questions in the chat box and comments. We are recording this, so be kind and polite. And we have 45 minutes together. In terms of housekeeping, this is a Zoom meeting, not a webinar. So you'll be on mute. We may come to you if you have time. And you know, please do, again, contribute. Now, most of all, I want you to introduce Haroon Tas, the Chief Innovation and Strategy Officer and member of the Executive Committee of Royal Philips. You're very, very welcome.
Yeah. Great to be here, David.
And you're very welcome, Michael, too, of course, my co-host. The question we're going to debate is this, is whether building ecosystems in healthcare is a pipe dream or a way of the future. Simple question, slightly provocative, as you'd expect. Michael, I know you've worked together a lot in the past. Why don't you give us a picture of the work you've done and then segue into the debate?
Well, given that we have a very short period of time, I wouldn't like to waste any of it speaking about work that can be accessed. Let me just say that it's been a pleasure. We've had the privilege of working with Jeroen and Serge Levy, who heads the M&A function in Philips, in a paper on healthcare ecosystems, which you can find through the website of evolutionlimited.net, and that provides more of an overview. And I guess that that started as a result of some conversations we had now well over a year ago about how to build ecosystems and what exactly is going on in healthcare. Because it's one of these areas that, as the pandemic showed, are so extremely important. And on the other hand, is an area that has a lot of unfulfilled potential. And I think that there's few people who can be better placed, having been involved in a number of different roles. Jeroen has been involved not only as the Chief Innovation and Strategy Officer in Philips, now member of the Board of Directors of Gaia-X, Europe's effort to create standards and facilitate these pipe dreams and turn them into reality, by some challenged in terms of what has happened so far. But also he's been involved as running part of a business and looking at businesses or investing in businesses. So I think that it'll give us hopefully more than one layers. But Jeroen, if you don't mind, could you give us a sense and could you explain to us why you guys bothered, which I guess was the focus of our first discussions and work together. Why even get interested in ecosystems? Why develop them in the first place? And in particular, what are the customer and patient outcomes that you're looking to meet? And why an ecosystem rather than doing it yourself or just using a slightly more established means?
Okay, well, you also asked me to give me to give you brief answers, but this is a very big question.
We'll have an exception here.
Let me start by saying that there are already very well established ecosystems in healthcare everywhere. The only problem is they're not digitized. So, you know, today, if you go to your GP and there's something wrong with you, he will refer you to a specialist or even a hospital. So there's a whole system of referrals where you're being passed from one organization to the other. Then a lot of the therapies and diagnostics are the result of ecosystems, typically research. So companies like Philips who develop diagnostic equipment or therapies will always work with university medical centers, with research organizations to come up with the evidence and efficacy of the diagnosis or the treatment. So it's not like ecosystems don't exist, but they're not digital at all and they don't have real scale. Actually, if you think about it, they're very local. You know, your GP is probably
what, within a mile from you? The hospital is probably within 2 miles. So it's a brick and mortar, you know, close to your home kind of play, instead of a true global play where we have access to the best knowledge, the best diagnostic capabilities around the globe, where the care is virtualized so that you don't need to wait 3 months, but can actually see the doctor now.
Well, your answer makes me think of Monsieur Jourdain in Molière's Bourgeois Gentilhomme, the guy who, when his poetry teacher speaks about prose, exclaims himself, "I have been speaking in prose all my life. We have been doing ecosystems all our lives, and we didn't know them." But there is a catch there, and you spoke about that catch, and part of that catch has to do with digital ecosystems and consciously orchestrated ecosystems that can unlock the value. So I'm going to introduce now the polls. I don't want us to be speaking about the polls, but if we can have the first poll running already, the polls are going to be asking the participants three questions. The first one has to do with healthcare ecosystems and big tech. Will future healthcare ecosystems be dominated by big tech? Could you all answer yes, no, or not sure? And the reason is that this is one of the critical questions that many of us, both in strategy and I guess having seen the dominance of big tech firms in strategy, have started also working on regulation, are concerned with, because there seems to be an ease and access of digitization that comes from big tech. We'll ask you two more polls, let's just get them all out of the way here. So the second poll, if we could just see whether governments can unlock the latent value of healthcare ecosystem through regulation and data synchronization. And I think that's another important question for us to think about, to see, well, if we have these ecosystems, they don't have scales, are governments going to help us, or are they going to be a bureaucratic hindrance? And now we can launch the third poll, and again, we'll share the results at the end, which is whether incumbents will be able to take advantage of these new opportunities. Because you spoke about these ecosystems that exist, but the question is, for the benefit of whom, or who will be able to be successful? And I guess that healthcare is a particular example, and now Philips becomes an interesting case of what makes Philips confident that it can play a role. So let me turn to my next question, which is about Philips in particular. What are the healthcare ecosystems that Philips is betting on? What is it thinking that it wants to develop?
Well, healthcare is very complex, and there's not one player. So I'm not talking about the large number of different providers. I'm also talking about insurance, so people who actually reimburse care. I'm talking about the pharmaceutical industry, governments that clearly play a role, because many governments still fund most of the healthcare in the Western world. So there are a whole lot of players. There's also technology that offers great opportunity to have these players more aligned in the outcomes. And if you look at the way care is being paid for these days in most Western countries, is what's called fee-for-service. So you basically pay for the services you get, for a diagnostic, for a consult, for a therapy, for home care. So if that's the case, people will try to optimize that. And then, of course, insurers and governments will try to put, you know, constraints on that, like quality, etc. We believe also that if the system change and can change, because now we have the data coming to us, we can move much more towards outcomes. So the reimbursement will move to basically for the outcome of the care you get, which is ultimately in the end what we want. We want not only to get health care, we basically want health. So if we have a system that promotes health and obviously tries to prevent disease, and as a disease happens, because it happens in all of us, that will then trigger the right intervention at the right time to avoid as much downstream complications and cost. I think that will open up the world towards, you know, different players, different combinations of players that will have to align against those outcomes. And you know better than I do, Michael, that the best ecosystems are the ones where the outcomes are aligned and common goals for the participants are clear.
Yeah, that's a great point on outcomes. And as I asked the question, I'd invite all the participants to put any questions they have on the chat, because we want this to be everyone involved. Haroon, you talked about outcomes there, and having done a lot of work on outcomes in different sectors, it's a higher promise, right, to the end customer or patient and so on. And it's one thing to promise it, it's another thing to deliver it, especially in ecosystems, often complex yeah. ecosystems. How do you create that alignment then you were talking about?
Well, first you have to align on what you want to measure. And there are quite a number of organizations that have, you know, a good example is iChon, that has identified these patients reported outcomes. So they're called prompts, patients reported outcome measurements. And that basically tracks that, for instance, if you have a hip or knee replacement, it defines what a good outcome is of a hip and knee or knee replacement. And that's being measured. And it's then measured across all the people that had a hip and knee replacement. So you know roughly what it should cost and what outcome you should seek. And that becomes then the benchmark, the baseline. Well, that's not the case today, because you go in, they're being paid for the diagnosis, for the surgery, for, you know, the home therapist that helps you recover, and it's all paid separately. And these people will pass you on as a patient from one place to the other, and nobody takes responsibility for the final outcome, which is you getting back on your feet, going back to work, playing sports, or whatever outcome in this case you're aiming at. So I think that can be done. It can be standardized, it can be measured. You can even measure it before you reimburse it that way. Yes. So you can say, whatever we do, we're going to measure these outcomes for everybody who has a hip or knee replacement or a stent insertion or a breast cancer surgery, and I can go on and on. And it gets more complex, of course, when you have people with multiple diseases. So, but then still you can measure it, and you can measure how much emergency care, how much readmission to the hospital, yes. what's your life, et cetera.
Yeah. And if you think about the objectives that exist and the value that is latent, and that's one of the big issues in healthcare ecosystems, that we can all intuitively understand why combining all of that good stuff together is going to be good both for patients and for the economy. It's going to reduce costs drastically by reducing hospital admissions. It's going to increase the quality of life. We also understand that there could, in principle, be ways to align these parties, but in practice, there is a lot of fragmentation. So if you want to put your finger to some specific bottlenecks, the things that essentially take this pipe dream of what healthcare could be and say, no, we really can do it. What are these and how can we address them?
Well, I think it starts with what I said. You have to put the right incentives in the system. So that's the biggest change. You know, if you put the incentives in the right place, the system will adjust to that. So then secondly, it's a big change management, because right now it's complex but well-defined. You do home care, you do home care. You run a surgery room, you run a surgery room, and you do surgery. Hmm. You do diagnosis, but actually a patient need diagnosis and surgery and home care.
Yeah.
So one way or another, that needs to come together. And that's not something the healthcare system is used to, because they have become more and more specialized, and therefore the number of referrals has increased. So now you want to bring that back together and say, hey, it's all about the outcome and it's all by working together. And maybe a lot of people don't have confidence that that will happen by itself, because therefore most people scored that big tech is probably going to do it, because, you know, they're one kind of monolithic organization that has a lot of power and therefore can make things happen. Amazon is very big and powerful, and therefore it becomes more big and powerful. And therefore people believe they can solve these kind of problems. Now, I personally don't believe it, but I believe they can play a role in it.
Michael, can I just, let's just go to, we've got some questions coming through now. And I know a couple of them are on the topic of the poll, but I'm keen to hear the voices of people listening to this discussion, if that's okay.
Absolutely. If you want, take a look and we can curate.
I'm ready to go.
Go ahead.
So a couple on data. So Julia asked the question of what role do you think the UK government, and I guess indeed other governments, can play to best promote the use of data and alignment without compromising privacy? And I guess related to that, you know, how are you dealing with the privacy requirements? This is from Daniela. And does it mean we need to join forces as pharma and healthcare companies to influence it? I think they're all part of the same question.
These are typically top of mind questions because I get them virtually every day. And, you know, I come from the financial services industry, and 25 years ago, we started working on shared payment networks. And the results you see today around you every day, you know, we can all pay with our phones anywhere or withdraw money because these payment networks are in place and work. So I know that we can scale this, we can do this, we can guarantee privacy, we can guarantee security because we've done it in another industry. I think the value of data in healthcare is way bigger than in any other industry because you need to have a longitudinal view of your own health to really understand it and determine whether you need an intervention or not. So I think that can be done. I don't think big tech will be allowed to own that data. That data will ultimately be under the ownership and consent of the patient. Mm-hmm. And obviously, government should play a role in enabling that to happen. So enabling that data to be deployed in a secured and privacy compliant infrastructure. That doesn't mean that the government should build these infrastructures because I don't think they have experiences in that, but they can definitely govern these kind of data infrastructures. So I'm a big proponent of what's called a health data space, where you create these data spaces for consumers or citizens, but under the governance of probably a combination of government, healthcare providers, and patient associations. That can be then executed by maybe even big tech, but definitely Philips, of course. But you set the conditions under which people can play. And that's also my role in Gaia X, where I keep promoting not to build another big cloud competitor to Google or, you know, that race is done and there are three winners. So, but you can still set the conditions under which they operate and what you do with data and how you govern data. And I think that's where we will end up. We'll set the conditions to play in a secure, privacy-compliant healthcare infrastructure, and that's going to be, by definition, an ecosystem play.
So let me just ask that, because I think that this relates to something that I know we have discussed in the past as well, where healthcare is probably leading the way of the challenges that society is facing in terms of many of the choices that can be developed are more easily developed when companies have the right to manage the data more broadly. And it is no accident that, of course, we have seen China have be the birthplace of innovations in terms of whether it is Ping An or the innovations healthcare by Ali or others, which may be facilitated by their scale. And even in the US, you have large, more integrated organizations. You've got Kaiser Permanente, and I know that Philips works with the FHA and VA, that because of its broad membership in terms of the people who are involved and the scope, you can start working. Now, the concern that I have is, although we can say that this is theoretically possible, as I see a number of the comments are saying, yeah, we have it, but it's just in small scale. Now, the problem is that you have the big players, big tech, but also some big industry players, that are taking advantage of it. And I'm a little bit concerned that it could be fun for the few players that are at the top, but it leads to a very polarized and uneven society, yeah, and in particular to difficulties in terms of the business that will emerge in the healthcare space. How do you think that we can address this issue of polarization that seems to have gone hand in hand with some of these new ecosystems that have grown in healthcare, in Asia more than in Europe or the US, but it's a very fast moving environment?
Yeah, and I think what you're saying is interesting, because indeed Kaiser has 17 million patients, so they can do basically whatever they want under the law to deal with their data. So they can create, they basically are like big tech, you know, they're the ones who set the rules of the ecosystem, if you will. And that has happened by default, you know, Apple sets the rules of the game, you know, you pay 30% to launch your app and your app needs to comply with 100,000 rules set up by Apple. So it is an ecosystem, but it's an ecosystem controlled by one big player. I think that's something we don't want in healthcare because there's too much at stake here. So I think by definitions, therefore, we should look at a much more level playing field. But since getting this playing field off the ground is hard, it will never take place in a fragmented market. You know, you describe the market, even in the UK where you have the NHS, still the NHS is almost like a loosely federated, you know, organization, if you think about it. There are very few decisions that are made at the central level. So the same applies to the Netherlands or Germany. In Germany, you have 1,000 or even thousands of hospitals that all do their own thing. So I think it's a dual approach where you have to convince people that if they participate in a digital ecosystem like this, they will benefit more than not being part of it.
Yes.
And I've seen that in the financial services world, because we started Citibank at that time. I worked at Citibank, and Citibank reached out to their biggest competitors, Chase Manhattan at that time, and said, hey, let's get together and create a payment network. And then all the restaurants can use single point of sale. They can go to any of our ADMs. And we know we're competitors, but now we're competing with 900 other banks. And we believe we are stronger individually when we're stronger together. And I think that kind of thinking has to come to healthcare as well, where we say, hey, in the Netherlands, we have 80 hospitals and we can try to compete, but healthcare is not a competitive market. We can also try to collaborate, optimize, create more innovation. And as a whole, the system will do better. Our role within that ecosystem becomes clearer and our contribution becomes clearer. And on the whole, we could even compete with our surrounding countries on healthcare services. And there are only a few players that really latched onto that idea. But there are also the top players in the world, like Mayo Clinic. They want to be like big tech. You know, they invested heavily in their own health data space, and they're creating an ecosystem of thousands of providers that can participate in that. So they clearly see in the future, and it's digital health services. Now, in most of the Western countries, definitely in the EU, people are more thinking of how can I protect my turf? I think the thinking should be, how can I contribute to something bigger and thereby become more valuable? And that thinking hasn't landed yet everywhere.
I'm curious, Ruan, about your involvement and obviously your participation in the exec co of Philips and your different roles. You've been CEOs, different groups. You've been obviously a chief strategy and innovation officer. Two questions really, which relate to some of the comments we're getting as well. One is that, you know, what have been the hardest strategic calls you've made in ecosystems about, for example, where you play? And related to that, how have you convinced, if you like, if you needed to, some of your colleagues in terms of how, you know, taking a more ecosystem mindset, particularly in digital?
Yeah.
So the strategy and the leadership, I'd be curious to be a fly on the wall, a virtual wall in your ExCo meetings. Give us a picture.
I think within a company like Philips, you have a similar problem like we see in healthcare in general. And what is the problem? It's a problem of sub-optimization. You know, I run my business. I have a great product. Let's say I'm responsible for ultrasound. Great, great business for Philips. We're market leader, high margins, good growth. So then there's this guy, Jeroen, who comes along and says, hey, you got to be on the platform. Because if you're on the platform, we're not only going to do ultrasound. No, we're going to combine ultrasound with other diagnostic modalities. And you know what we're going to do? We're going to get deeper insight in disease. So therefore, we can be more valuable for the people that use. And they go, yeah, great idea. Okay, now I have to implement two more features because my customer are asking. And I definitely will come on the platform. But, you know, it's going to be in 2025.
Right.
So I basically was convinced we needed a platform because I could see that first we need an ecosystem within Philips itself. So instead of having separate products, I felt that our only reason for being a company is when your portfolio has cohesion and you do something valuable and the parts are coming together to create a whole that's more. And, you know, to me, that's a key to a company, but it's also a key to an ecosystem. Mm. And that's not natural behavior because people feel more comfortable in their own world where they say, hey, let me manage my ultrasound. I know ultrasound's way better than you do. I know what my customers want. They tell me they want these three features and I have to go heads down because I promised them and next month I have to deliver it. So, you know, yeah, we'll do the platform.
But this is a big challenge, and let me just push a little bit more on that because that's my experience in a number of organizations, and the ones that don't usually have a CEO who's sort of totally bought the idea. So I remember I was in Tsinghua just before meeting Zhang Rimin, the CEO of Haier, and I remember going through the elevators, and I saw in Chinese, my Chinese non-existent, so I had to ask the minders exactly what it was, this picture that had submarines and rockets. I was like, what is this? And they're like, this is where we jot down ecosystem revenue because we want business units to report not only their own sales, but the way that they generate ecosystem revenues. And, you know, the best ones are rockets. And, you know, anyone who's been in China knows how people appreciate the explicit recognition. And the ones on the bottom are submarines. I did not ask what happened to the people in submarines. But what is interesting is that when you've got the strong hand of CEO saying, your fridge will order milk, and I don't want this to be Alibaba, I want this to be me, or find another way of connecting to the customer and adding some value. And let's leave these issues of market dominance aside for a moment. You can see how they can drive it. And I've seen that also in some of the other, you know, speaking with your counterpart, Jonathan Larson in Ping An, how, you know, their CFO is driven to look at measurables. In an organization that is of the more traditional sort, a major European big tech like Philips, which has multiple stakeholders and each of the stakeholders has power. I suspect that there's going to be a lot more convincing that needs to happen, but what can you do to facilitate these conversations from what you have seen?
Yeah, and to be honest, our CEO is pretty visionary and he's the reason I joined Philips and took on the challenge here to turn us into a digital solutions rather than an analog product company. I think what we did is basically work from the outside inward. So if you're a large healthcare provider, what's more important to you, the two features on the ultrasound or dramatically improving your diagnostic capability? If you're a healthcare provider, is it more important that you can do 30% more procedures in a day and, you know, deal with the huge backlog you have, or are you really interested in one or two of the features? So the answer is always the same thing that comes back. We're interested in becoming a better healthcare player. So I say, okay, if that's the case, then how do we work our way backwards? If we say, hey, are we selling to the guy in the basement or are we selling to the guy in the corner office. So if we're selling to the guy in the corner office, we better have more of a business outcome approach to it. And therefore, the way we not only sell, but the way we integrate and the way we link our propositions become more important, because that guy in the corner office will also say, yeah, but I also have GE equipment and I have a medical record system from Cerner. So please tell me how you're going to play with these guys, because I'm not going to kick them out. So that then forces you also to think in context. And that's not necessarily how people think when they focus on a product with features. So now you're forcing people to say, hey, this is the environment where your proposition is going to add value. Now let's talk about what that value might be. And it's always, you know, healthcare should be four things. It should create better health outcomes for patients. Mm. It should be a better experience for patients. It should be a more efficient care, so therefore help the bottom line. And it should be a better experience for the care provider. So now go and figure out how you score on these four, and then tell me what you need from the others to get you there. Mm. So we've tried to kind of flip the discussion from product plus to true customer need down. Mm. And constantly forcing that discussion starts making a difference, and starting measuring that makes a big difference. So I basically ask every business to create a dashboard for their customer on these four dimensions. And then I don't know how to do it. Our customers didn't ask for it, you know. I said, yeah, but go and do it, even if they don't ask for it.
Mm. You've answered Kay Muller-Hesker's question brilliantly, which she asked about KPIs. Just coming to, I guess, to the more recent experience, there's a few questions here, both in the Netherlands and the UK, around what have we learned about ecosystems in the pandemic, particularly, for example, around the rollout of the vaccines, and what can we take forward as we move with optimism out of the pandemic? There were at least three or four questions there.
Yeah, that's a good question, because, you know, I really started wondering why did Israel and the UK do so much better on the whole vaccination compared to the EU? You know, the beginning of the pandemic was, I wouldn't judge that, but it was definitely not stellar. But the whole vaccination program, you know, has been quite a success in the UK. Then I found out that the UK actually took a completely different approach than the EU. So the lady who led the program has, by the way, a venture background. So she said, well, what we're not going to do is tell the pharmaceutical companies start negotiation on price and delivery dates. We see this as a complex emerging problem. So what we're going to do is we're going to offer them up the possibility to do clinical trials, to help with production facilities, and to help with the logistics, the three most important, you know, gating factors to the success of vaccination. And in return for that, we want to have, you know, preference when it comes to distribution of the vaccine. And then you go to Israel, and basically they did a similar kind of deal. They basically said, we have three healthcare systems. We have electronic records. Why don't we do as follows? We'll give you anonymized data on patients, because it's not about just who's being vaccinated and what happens afterwards. It's also, what's the history of those patients? You know, yes. Did they have issues with their immune system before? Do they have, you know, a lung disease? Do they have heart disease? You know, what symptoms did they show before? So actually, in return of sharing that data, they got the first batches of vaccines. And again, they didn't even negotiate on price, etc. So the EU sent their civil servants to negotiate on price and delivery schedules. Mm. So they tried to make a good deal. Now, making a good deal is great in a very stable, well-defined, mature environment. Making a deal on price and delivery is not a good approach when you're dealing with the complexity of an emerging problem. Then in my mind, you cannot resolve on your own. You need to create an ecosystem approach to it. And at the back, of course, you also need that science in ecosystem where people start sharing protocols, data, insights, so that we can really inject some speed in the way we develop, manufacture, and distribute medicine. And I was, by the way, blown away by how fast this all went, and even despite all the holes, you know, the industry has done a pretty good job in dealing with the vaccination.
Crisis is always a good opportunity for us to see latent value, perhaps in areas where we have not seen it before. Let me just try to bring it a level down from the discussion and learning and interaction government and big pharma to what we can see in healthcare, where Philips has the role of the big company, and thinking about the other complementers, because we've had a few questions asking about complementers. And, you know, there's a couple of questions that saying, well, look, the problem is the process infrastructure in companies that is a significant barrier to collaboration over and above the vision, which sounds wonderful in the C-suite. But, you know, if you look at the reality and the people on the ground, I don't know what you guys are talking about ecosystems. We still have the same RFPs and the same 3-month delays before we even get an answer. And also thinking about the opening up, because much of the idea behind having these ecosystems is the co-creation of value in areas where you don't have the answer and you want to leverage the big tail of potential solutions that comes from complementers. So let's now think about your relationship with the complementers. Let's think about all of these problems in turning this idea into practice. What do you think big companies can try to learn, if I may be so bold, in terms of facilitating value co-creation or creating the conditions for a more vibrant ecosystem? And you can speak of successes or of the things that you have been a bit of a bottleneck, even in your own experience.
Yeah, I think the whole idea of opening up is probably the most important one. The recognition that if you want to really want to have impact and address big challenges like we have in healthcare, there's just no way you can do it on your own. So you might have the most brilliant researchers and developers in your company. You're just not going to do it on your own. So given that, then what's the best way to do it? So how do you engage in a different way? And that's not easy because, as you already implied, maybe some of the processes, the legal department, the IP department, you know, may still be 20 years back in time while you're going 20 years ahead in time. So, and I think what we started to do is really providing the evidence that opening up your systems, opening up the ecosystem with faster innovators than yourself, with research organizations can create wonderful, beautiful outcomes. And I can give you, for instance, you know, we believe that we can still do much more minimally invasive procedures. So where you used to open up a person to do surgery, you can now put a smart catheter inside, treat a cancer, treat a heart problem, treat a stroke, etc. So for instance, we decided to collaborate with our biggest competitor in that space, Medtronic. We're collaborating with quite a number of university medical centers that provide input to us, that help us with the clinical evidence. We're engaging now upfront also with payers and saying, hey, we're not only going to give you the clinical evidence, we're going to work on the economic evidence as well. And instead of doing it after we launch the product, we actually do it when we conceive the product. So we basically upfront put our stake in the ground and say, this is the claims we're going after. Now work with us on creating the evidence, maybe work with us on some of the research, and work with us on the services that we can deliver. And now here's a big change from where we're coming from, because if you look at the hardware world, it's quite a discrete world. And what I mean with that is I create a module, I plug it into your hardware, you package it and sell it. But the software world is super flexible. And everything in software can be a service. So I can even have a tiny little service that can contribute, for which I can be reimbursed. So it gives us so much more flexibility to combine these services into something bigger that still flows back to in proportion to the contribution. And that's something people have to wrap their mind around, because they still think in discrete, you know, almost zero sum thinking.
Yeah.
And this is the opposite of zero-sum thinking.
It's a big mindset shift.
Let's do the 30-second section of our interview, given the time. 30 seconds. The last question we got from Peter. Where do you draw the border between corporation and own IP protection, which touches on exactly what you said, and it came as you were speaking. And then we will show the responses that we got, and we'll ask you for your view. 30 seconds. Corporation and IP protection.
If you have a service, you own the IP and you manage the IP, you just are focused on the outcome of that service and make it pluggable and easy to consume. So it will change the game.
Absolutely. Let's go to the results. Result number one. David, want to tell us, walk us through. Let's see the results. First result. Okay. First result is...
So you can read it. I mean, I'm curious about Harun's reaction to each of these three. The first one was about healthcare being dominated by big tech. Pretty mixed picture.
Let me react. I think I already reacted to that because I think a lot of people have more confidence of big tech to disrupt than a government to disrupt itself. So, and I think what's behind this is, what's going to be the force to drive this? I personally don't believe that healthcare will be dominated by big tech, but I'm certain that big tech will play a big role. And but I think we have to learn to think like big tech. We have to learn to understand how Amazon creates a service out of everything, and everything is a platform. You know, there's no reason other companies can follow that playbook. And I think here's something interesting also. I spoke to somebody from the automotive industry, and he said that Europe has a tremendous automotive ecosystem. The only problem is it's not digitized yet, but it's one of the best ecosystems. So we have to become digital very quickly and build on that ecosystem expertise. And then we can go and beat the Teslas of the world. If we don't do it, we're not going to beat the Teslas of the world. And Tesla is going to be the big tech.
Okay, so for the 30 seconds for the final two, which is first, the fairly good news, I guess, that most people think that governments are going to be able to unlock the value. And the question is, how will you help? Perhaps not from your Philips role, but from Gaia X. And the final one has to do with established firms being able to take advantage, where the crowd seems to be positive. What is your take on that? And then we'll wrap that up.
Okay. The incumbents, healthcare is really complex. And I was talking about trust earlier. Trust is super important. And you know, if your product has been in the hands of millions of patients and providers, that gives you a leg up. You just need to change the way you think about your propositions. On the government, I think the government has to deal with this, because everywhere around the world, the cost of healthcare is still exceeding, the growth cost of healthcare is exceeding GDP growth. There's a shortage of qualified staff. So populations are graying. So, you know, you can fill in the rest. Something has to give.
So we have to learn it. And this is what we will try to do in this series. A couple of things for all of the participants. The first thing is, we're going to send you a link, which is to Menti. So this link, which is open, will allow you to tell us what are the things that are the key priorities. So We'll have much more. As I said, there's a paper that co-authored with Jeroen and Sergio that we'll give you a link to. And there's much more that may cover some of your questions. Next week, we will be speaking with another friend and collaborator, the CEO of Majid Al Futtaim, the biggest property and mall owner in the GCC that is bridging the physical and the digital infrastructures. But David, why don't you rub us up and give us your thoughts?
I thought it was a brilliant discussion. I think I love the fact that you could move from big picture to the granularity of actually how you make ecosystems work. You brought examples from other industries, and there was a candor in terms of the necessity. So they're not, doesn't sound like they're a pipe dream, sounds like they are a way of the future. We have a link going in the comments for the next session. So if you haven't signed up, do sign up to them. We'd love your feedback on this series. We are trying to make this real, practical, as well as strategic. Just wanted to say thank you for your participation and what a great discussion. And most of all, Jeroen, thank you for your time and interest and expertise. Much
appreciated. That flew by, David. It was a great discussion. Thanks so much for having me on the program.
Pleasure.
Jeroen, great to see you again. Thanks so much. Thanks, everyone. See you in 3 weeks, Wednesday.